Great. So it's my honor to welcome you all to the WiCyS 2023 conference in Denver. I've been to all, yeah, let's give it up, let's go. We're actually coming back. We were here in 2021, so it's nice to be back here in the Rocky Mountains. And we had nice snow this morning. I hope everybody got in okay. So my name is Dr. Elizabeth Hawthorne. And as I said, I've attended all of the WiCyS conferences. And we have some of the t-shirts on display here. This is kind of my funny thing I like to do. So this lime green t-shirt represents the one from the very first WiCyS conference in 2014 in Nashville, Tennessee. The one in the middle here is in 2019 in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. I think that's my favorite shirt. It just feels nice. And then this one is the current one in 2023. The ones we have here in front of the panel are just some other representative shirts. The green one is from last year in Cleveland, and it was actually, we gave this panel on St. Patrick's Day, so that's the nice green color there. And then this one here, it says 2021, but if you turn the shirt around, it also says 2020. Right? So it was kind of a dual purpose shirt. So we all know what happened in 2020. We weren't able to get together. So the conference organizers were really smart and said, we're stronger together in 2021 and beyond. So this is one of favorite shirts because it represents a period in time, right? A sign of the times. I also have the pleasure of working for Rider University in New Jersey after retiring as a community college educator after 30 years. I retired and they said, Ryder said to me, why don't you come and start our master's degree in cybersecurity? So I also am the graduate director of the online program in cybersecurity. So shameless plug, if you're interested in that, stop by the booth, I'll be there, okay. I think that's enough about me. I'd like to go ahead and turn it over to the panelists to welcome you and to give a brief introduction, who they are, who they represent, and when they had their first WiCyS conference experience. So we're just gonna go in order. So China's gonna pick up the mic and take it from there.
Okay, hi everybody. My name is China Ling. I started WiCyS my first conference was 2019 in Pittsburgh. It was amazing. I was like a sophomore in college, recently like a kid adult. And I was like, oh my gosh. I was the only one from my university who went. And it was a little nerve-wracking at first, but I really enjoyed it. I'm actually a recent graduate in cybersecurity systems.
Next.
Hi, everyone. I'm Littany Lineberry. I currently attend Mississippi State University, but my first WiCyS conference was in 2015 when it was in Texas. And it was kind of overwhelming, but I learned to pace myself. So, and ever since then, I have really enjoyed coming back. And my major is engineering education, but my focus is cybersecurity for my dissertation.
Hi, my name is Diane Rose. I'm an industry professional. I have 28 years in IT, so that kind of dates me a little bit. Half of that is focused on cybersecurity. So I'm part of Asurion's security leadership team, and I lead their security risk management capability. In case you haven't heard of Asurion before, we're a tech care company. Here's my little plug. We're a tech care company that's focused on helping consumers get more enjoyment out of their technology devices. So we repair, replace, do tech support, anything for any smart device. I've attended WiCyS four times. I attended the very first one in Nashville that was, I guess, 300 and some people. And then I attended in 2021 and 2022. And I kind of played a dual role there. I was there as a sponsor, as well as I played the role of a recruiter because our recruiting team was not traveling yet due to COVID. So I manned the career booth, and I really had a lot of fun doing that. So this is my first year really getting to experience the full conference. And just wanted to let you know, we do have recruiters that are here traveling with us this year. They're booth 214, and we have two summer security internships. If anybody's interested, please stop by and say hi to them.
Hi, my name is Colin Okafor. I work with EY in the cybersecurity practice. I would say I don't know how I got here, because in 2021, I was sitting right where you guys were sitting now as a first-timer coming to WiCyS. And I would say that was my first major conference. It was overwhelming because I didn't have a plan of whatever. I just said, okay, let me come to WiCyS and then be part of whatever is happening here. I'm here today not because I am the best or I've been someone that has put in much more, but I kind of agree and believe in what WiCyS stands for, which is for us to build our community, right? My second conference was in Cleveland. Right to say that Denver here is like a pilgrimage ground for me, because right here I got the job I do now in EY, right here. Now, that was my first conference. I was in my first year doing my master's degree in cybersecurity at the University of Houston. I didn't come looking for a job here in 2021 because I still had 1 year to go. But I got the job. I got Deloitte here. I got EY here in the career fair. So this is my third one, and I'm speaking here to inspire and encourage others that if I can do this, you all can do that. Thank you.
Excellent.
Hi, everyone. My name is Esther, and I'm a software engineer in data security at Salesforce. Currently live in the Bay Area. I first started at WiCyS in 2015 when it was in Dallas. They were partnering with UT Dallas, which is where I went for my undergrad. And so I started as like a student volunteer. Dr. Strzok, who's like one of the main organizers, she was my professor, and she also was like the faculty sponsor for our Women in Computer Science Club. So it was really an honor to get to work with her back in my undergrad. And this is my seventh conference, so I'm really excited to be here and on this panel.
Hello, I am Dr. Elizabeth Rasnick. I'm from the University of West Florida. So the snow this morning was frightening. I'm in their Center for Cybersecurity. We do outreach. I'm an assistant professor, so I teach classes. I've actually been in industry. I've taught computer science, which included some cybersecurity, in high schools. So I've done the gamut, and this community is fabulous. My first one was Pittsburgh. And so we've been Denver twice, and then we had the virtual conference to try to make up for things in 2020. The shirts are fabulous. Start your collection now, because you'll see they go up in value, because you can't get them in later years.
Great, thank you. Okay, so what we're going to do is go through 10 questions I'm going to pose to the panelists, then we'll open it up for any questions from you in the audience. So before we get started, we're just going to have maybe a 50-second music clip, from a group called Mercy Me, called Dear Younger Me. And then I'm going to turn it to each of the panelists. We'll just go down the row like we did before and say, what advice would you offer to yourself as a first-timer at WiCyS? And we all know when you started, because you just admitted it. So, okay.
Dear younger me, where do I start? If I could tell you everything that I have learned so far, then you could be one step ahead of all the painful memories.
things still running through my head. I wonder how much different things would be, dear younger me.
I know, everybody's getting into the drum, I know. I play the Irish drum, the Beauron, so that's why you saw me snapping up here. Okay, so if you were gonna give some advice to your dear younger me, attending a WiCyS conference, here's your opportunity, China.
It's just always gonna start with me, it's okay. So
for my first time, I would have told myself to definitely not be as nervous as I was and to talk to a lot more people, especially at like breakfast and lunch. And once I did find somebody, I kind of stuck with them the whole time. I wish I would have more been brought out and just kind of went to other people. And then when I started bringing other people with me from my other university or from my university, to not have them always be around me, to like have us all spread out so that everybody could learn more about like where we came from and like who we were.
For me, I would say pace yourself and do it. I would say pace yourself and do as much as possible in your schedule and try to do different workshops, of course, but also networking. So I wish I would have networked more my first year than I did, but after that I did. So as a first timer, network and attend as many workshops as possible.
Yeah, mine is kind of along that similar line, but for me, in 2014, I can honestly say I didn't understand the significance of this organization and the power and the impact and the support here. So really, you know, leverage the people that are here, make connections. Think of this as your tribe. We are here to help you be successful.
Okay, so for me, I would say don't try to be everywhere. I almost tried to be everywhere in every workshop, everything that is happening, and then ended up having half and half. I will come in 5 minutes, I'll dash out to another place, but then be organized, strategize, and then plan your conference. Pick the workshop that matters to you, that speaks to you. Don't be everywhere. Thank you.
Yeah, I would say definitely use the Hoover app to your advantage. You can, you know, pre-save all the sessions that you want to go for, and it's definitely a great app to have. I don't even know if we really had that when I first started out here, because yeah, we just had like these paper books. But I would also say definitely like think about what is your goal or goals in the conference. So some of you might be, you know, looking for jobs, and you might end up spending all of your time in the career fair and the career village and not really get to spend, you know, as much time in the sessions. Or maybe you're here to learn or to network. So definitely kind of tailor your agenda based off of that. And definitely, you know, what Colin said, you won't be able to be everywhere at once. And that's okay. It's kind of a draining experience, but it's such a rewarding one. And so you get to decide how you're going to make the most of it.
Get ready to be surprised. So my first conference, didn't know anybody here, was just getting into cybersecurity, and 6 months later, with the people that I met at that first conference, we were building the Georgia affiliate of WiCyS. So 2 years later, I've moved, and I'm in Huntsville, Alabama, and I'm on the board as an officer in the Northern Alabama affiliate. Time goes on, now I'm in Florida, and guess what? I'm now an officer in the Florida affiliate. So I would never have imagined when I showed up to my first WiCyS that there was leadership in front of me and building a community. Like I said, we built the Georgia affiliate and we had just met at that WiCyS. So be surprised, get ready for surprises, and just open your arms and get ready to embrace it.
Okay, good advice. Okay, question number two. What has been your favorite moment at a WiCyS conference? And why don't we start with Collins on that one?
Okay, so for me, my favorite moment in the conference is the keynote. Now, people will ask, why keynote? Even though I came in as a student, I should be thinking about networking, going to career fair, but I was looking at the keynote time, because the speakers you have in the keynote, they have stories to tell. And those stories kind of help build who you are going to be. They inspire you because they give you real-time story about how they started, where they are from, or what they are doing in the industry. So I never missed the keynote. I come early, I sit in the front, I forget about anything because I want to understand. And then what I did also was, after the keynote, I hang around to catch the speaker and then have a one-on-one, how do I get to you? How do you mentor me? So that was the favorite moment for me is attending the keynote.
Great. Diane next. Diane the other way. Okay.
Thank you. I'd say for me, it was in 2021. I met Dr. Amberine Siraj for the first time in person. She's the founder of this impactful organization, and she had been nominated for Cybersecurity Person of the year before. And it just was so inspirational to me that here was this woman, and look at this impact that she was having on this field. And at that moment in my career, I was leading a diversity, equity, and inclusion women's committee at Asurion that was over the technology and security space. And I felt like, you know, she's making this different in the industry, and I'm connected with her because I'm trying to create that same culture of inclusion within Asurion. And so it just, that inspiration, again, that connection, that drawing energy from someone else was my favorite moment.
Wonderful. Whitney?
So my favorite part of the conference is always the workshops, because of all of the breadth of information that is given that I can take back to my own institution, and I can share it with not only the students, but also the faculty. And the faculty are always so interested, like, oh, okay, so this, how can we implement this in our curriculum? So I always enjoy the workshops.
Great. I think we're going to go to Esther next, and then Elizabeth.
My favorite moment was in 2021. You know, it was middle of the pandemic, and we didn't really know what the conference was going to look like. But I heard from Dr. Strzok that they had, you know, stored a lot of the swag that they were going to give out in 2020, and they kind of repurposed it for 2021, as you heard Beth say, with the T-shirt. And I just loved the tagline, Stronger Together, because I really felt a part of this community of, you know, strong women and allies. And it was just like a really great experience to, you know, finally see people in person. And even though the pandemic may or may not be over, it's just... it's wonderful to, like, year after year, know that you can see so many wonderful people and learn a lot at this conference.
So they have the little photo backdrops, and last year, in front of one of those backdrops, I got to take a picture with a current student who was here on a student scholarship, with a previous student who'd had a student scholarship when she was a student, but was now here representing the company she works for, Palo Alto. She's here this year representing them. So for me to see that I had my own little pipeline of cybersecurity professionals, and I now had some that were in the profession and other ones that were coming up through it, that just made my heart burst getting to take a picture with them.
Wonderful. Excellent. Question number three for the panelists, and we're going to start with China. How do I make the most out of my time at the WiCyS Conference?
I would definitely say going to the
career village is definitely a must. Definitely getting that headshot in, because I always go every year and I was like, yay. Doing that and really sitting down with people to go over your resume is a really big thing. I've always had a really mismatched resume, and I go every year for them to like look it over and make sure it looks good, because everything is always an update on it, especially when you're a student. Anything that you can put down matters. And definitely going to like your specific workshops that you think will help you the most, especially if you're a student, going to them can help you in classes.
Great. Litany next, and then Diane.
Okay, so I want to also piggyback on what Shina said. Definitely going to the Career Village, not only for your resume, but for me, I have always been in academia. So before I got my PhD, I was in academia. So my resume is more of a CV. And so going there and getting industry persons to look at and say, well, you need to do this, this, and this so that it could be viable for an industry job. So that's one thing to definitely look at.
Before you pass the mic, can you just tell us what a CV is?
Oh, sorry, a curriculum vitae. Sorry. It basically goes through everything, like classes you've taught and descriptions and where you taught at. So kind of like a resume, but longer.
For professors.
For right? professors, yeah. Or those going to academia.
Thank you.
Mine would be start thinking about the people around you and how to create your trusted network. So people that can potentially be a mentor for you, somebody that you can go to and ask questions, somebody that can provide support for you. You need to create your own little tribe that you feel safe with, and use them as a support network. So I'd say that would be one of them. The other one would be when you network, and I think networking is incredibly important, and I'll just be the first to say I'm not the best at doing it. But my husband's a recruiter, and I asked him, like, how do I be a better networker? And so what he told me is what I'm going to share with you, and that's that just be genuine. Like, don't try to network with an end goal in mind. Just be genuine and try to make personal connections with people, because you never know where that's going to lead. Like, that will just organically lead to goodness.
Hang on, we're gonna switch the slide. And now, Collins, you're up. Yeah, what advice can you offer about making the most out of networking opportunities at WiCyS? So Diane kind of discussed that, but we wanna talk specifically now about networking opportunities.
Okay, me?
You.
I should go? Oh, okay.
You. I'm talking to you.
Okay, so in terms of networking, my own strategy was different, because in 2021 when I came here, I was like, I have to talk to everyone. Whoever I see, well, my name is Collins, and they're like, I say, yeah, Collins, right? And then I network with almost everyone. I don't want to know what you know, your potential, but I know I'm gonna get something out of you. That was for students like me. For the people from the industry, I want to know what you can offer. Where can I come in? That is also part of the networking. Then for the speakers, I did so many funny things. I will hang around, I will wait when the speaker is done, I will catch her up at the door, and then I will bring out my phone. Can we take a selfie? And I do that. Before she gets home after the conference, she's seen my picture with her. I said, you remember me? This is me and you. Oh, yeah. And it helped me get connected. And then I keep asking questions. Now, I didn't stop there. I could wake up one morning, and then I remember, Beth, I just go to LinkedIn. Hi, Beth. The temperature is zero here. How is yours? That's enough. She remembers me. I kept that going, right? Now, when you disconnect from people you connect to here, you are keeping yourself far away. Because we know that your network determines your network, who you connect with. And then I can tell us here that everyone sitting down here has a potential, has something to share. You might be thinking that you are just learning, but you're a mentor to someone. Whatever little you know, sharing gives you that ability to learn more. So I kept reaching out, I kept asking. Even the ones that did not reply back to me, I kept pushing until some of them became my mentor, up to today, right? So my advice would be network, keep in contact, don't break the communication. The people you are seeing sitting down here, I can tell you, they will build their community of your success.
Excellent. Litany and then China.
So for me, with networking, I would suggest when my first year here at WiCyS Conference, I went to the career fair and I went to the different booths that I thought I might be interested in as far as job-wise. And I struck up a conversation, like Colin said, you know, get their contact information. And back then we handed out business cards, but I think with Whova now, if you can just connect with them through the messenger and just keep in contact and then get their LinkedIn and follow up that way as well. So definitely, if you have, and even now, if you have business cards while you're here, still give them your business card as well.
So a big thing I think is definitely the Whova app. If you go into there, everybody who's at this conference is in there. Anybody and everybody, look them up. And then it has like their bio and their connections and everything like that. Especially if you can't get hold of a speaker right away, I definitely would hit them up on the Whova app. That's kind of what I do, especially with like recruiters. And then you can also see whatever businesses are here and who you need to go see. And definitely just networking wise within like breakfast, lunch, dinner, sit at different tables each time with different people and just talk to whoever's at your table, because you never know who you sit with. And then next thing you know, it's somebody like from the NSA and you're just like, oh, hello, I need a job. So definitely talking during that time is a really good time because everybody's more chillaxed, they're, you know, eating. And just definitely, you know, don't try to be shy and just be genuine about what you want and stuff.
Very good. We're moving on to the next question. And we have Diane, Litany, and Collins. So let me read the question, since we're being recorded and this will be spun up as a podcast. What tips can you offer for finding internships and career opportunities? And I'd like to start with Diane.
All right. So I apologize.
We have the job board.
I'm sorry, Beth. So the first thing I would say is think about the organizations that are here as a sponsor for WiCyS. So all of them obviously are very, DEI is very important to them. So I would say start with them and definitely hit the career fair, because many of them are here, just like Ashurian. They have recruiters there. They can tell you about the jobs. You'll get an opportunity to talk to them directly about what the intern program looks like. They don't all look the same. I do recommend that you do some homework up front before you go in there. From having been somebody that covered the career fair myself and worked that side of it, it's always really it's really nice to see somebody that did a little bit of homework and research up front. They know what the company is about. They know maybe what positions are already available. You can Google, just look at early careers for the company that you're looking at, and you'll get some really good information there. Also check out the job board, as Beth mentioned, and make sure you have your resume in the WiCyS resume database, because all of the sponsors have the ability to download that database. And so even if they don't have a position that's open right now, they may have something available in the future that they'll pull from that list from.
Great. Litany, Collins, and then I'm going to call an audible and ask Esther to also weigh in, since she's from Salesforce.
So for me, I will again suggest making what she said, make sure you have your resume, whether on the uploaded or a physical copy. Sometimes they may ask you if you have it, if you don't have it uploaded to the site, if you have it, a physical one with you. And then also for internships, don't think about, oh, well, I'm a freshman, or this is my first year or my second year. Still go for that internship. Still go to that career fair booth and talk to them, because you never know. They might like what you're saying, and or they might like your resume and say, well, I'm going to give this to so-and-so. So don't let you being a undergrad or a freshman or sophomore mainly deter you from going to the career fair and seeking internships.
Great advice. Collins and then Esther.
Yeah, so for me, the advice I'll give for students here, both international and then the domestic, is this. The way I did mine was always clicking submit. Clicking submit. I don't pay to submit. I click to submit, and it goes, right? Get your resume. Have someone else review your resume. Have a second opinion. And then when you connect with some of the recruiters, you might not be asking for if they have opening, but you can say, can I get you look at my resume? It helps. I did it many times. Now, for international students here, when you visit the career fair, what I did as an international student also, was, if I come to any booth, the first question I ask is, do you sponsor work visa? No, I move on. I pick these works, I move on to the next one. And then after meeting the target of the ones that sponsor, I come back to those ones that don't sponsor. I now want to know what you do, what you can do if eventually decide to sponsor, and then I keep the contact. So that's my advice. Nothing more, nothing less.
Great.
So I would say, the career fair can be a little overwhelming, because especially during the peak hours, it gets very crowded. There's going to be, you know, a lot of people at different tables. But definitely don't get discouraged. Even if you have to wait a little bit, you know, just try to plan ahead and know that it might take a little bit longer to get time with the recruiter. But another way is that if you're interested in any of the companies that are hosting the socials tonight, they usually have like tons of recruiters from each company at the, well, the from each company that's hosting the socials. So that might be another way to get some more one-on-one time. Are they offering the mock interviews this year at the Career Village? Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So that's a really great way to practice, along with like getting your resume reviewed and, you know, getting a headshot. Make sure to update your LinkedIn. But also, you know, you might find when you're sitting at lunch next to someone, you know, they might work for a company and you might get to know them, and maybe they'll say, oh, I can refer you for a position. So you never really know. And that's why networking is just so important. And it's great to meet people, too.
Great. We're going to move to the next question, and I'm going to have Elizabeth start. Okay, what advice would you offer about pursuing certifications, college degrees, in either cybersecurity or other majors?
Your least favorite two words. It depends.
That's the attorney's answer.
So it really does depend. There are companies where if you have a degree in cybersecurity, they consider that equivalent to the early entry-level certificates. So you could do either one. Really what it comes down to is, what is it you want to do and who do you want to work for? Because each company is going to have their own preferences and their own requirements, and so that's what you need to keep in mind. And there are all kinds of different certificates out there. So not everybody needs to start with an A+ certificate and then a Network Plus certificate and go on up from there. It depends on what you want to do and where you want to go. So keep that in mind and do your research. Look into it. You may not need one of the traditional certificates for the type of thing that you want to do. If you want to get into digital forensics, there are a whole other set of certificates that you get into that are not through the traditional certificate path. It might be that a degree in digital forensics is enough to get you the position that you want, so you don't need one. So do your research, figure out what your goals are, and plan from there.
Okay, Esther?
So I would say also, you know, take into consideration what your budget is, because some certifications are going to be very expensive. Like, for example, the SANS courses, they're really great, but they're also very expensive. I've heard that the Security Plus certification from CompTIA, it's like really great baseline, just covers a lot of broad security things. But if you're a student, you know, the employers aren't necessarily going to expect you to have any certifications, because you're probably, you know, involved maybe in a club or some related coursework that might help you instead. But certifications could be great for people that are considering, you know, career changing and going from some other field into cybersecurity. That could be a great way to demonstrate that you're already trying to learn security concepts.
Great. Collins? And then Diane.
Yeah, so in this regard, I would say for me, coming from the perspective of being a student, I first went for a retraining. My background initially was accounting. I was an accountant. I didn't go for certification first because I wanted to have the total background of what cybersecurity was all about. And then I had to go back to college. Now, after getting my degree, that was when I felt it was nice now for me to go for certification to prove that I've learned whatever I've learned in school, I can demonstrate with my certification that I have. And going forward for me, coming from that student perspective, I went through being a student, retraining before going for certification. And then the way I pursue my certification is I tailor them to what the capability I'm aligning to. I don't chase every certification that is available out there. I look at where am I heading to, and then I go for those certifications in order to save cost, not paying for things you don't need. So that would be my advice.
Well, let me first admit that I have an art and photography degree. So that's obviously I'm going to partly be the basis of my response. So I came into security, honestly, through osmosis. And I tell this story to a lot of people. I came in as a program manager supporting a portfolio of security projects and realized that I loved this stuff. And I begged my boss to just let me tag along to every single meeting I could and let me just be a sponge. So, you don't have to have a certification or a degree to get into the field, but let me tell you, it most assuredly will help. it's what a recruiter's gonna be looking for. There's certain buzzwords, they're gonna look to see, do you have an industry cert or a degree? Or have you had real life experience in the field? So you have to have something to kind of give yourself that leg up, or be fortunate enough to have somebody like me that had somebody that was willing to let me just be a sponge and tag along and learn it along the way. The other thing is that security nowadays is not just forensics, pen testing, vulnerability management, and incident response. It is so much more than that. There's direct overlaps. Our security organization includes privacy, identity and access management, data governance. So think about that, you know, like what inherent skills do you already have? Where are you strong in? And how do you leverage your inherent skills and build upon them with certifications and degrees? Now, I will also say that I believe that the more formal education and training you have, the higher your pay band will likely be. So that's also, you know, a reason to try to make sure you have that under your belt, but you don't have to have it to get in. You just have to be creative.
Okay, thank you. And I'm actually gonna weigh in on this one as well. So my background is in computer science. Like I mentioned before, I was a community college educator for 30 years. I would say about 25 of those years was computer science, programming. And then I said, you know, this cybersecurity stuff is exciting. I want to figure out how I can do that. So I studied and I got a certification, CISSP. I also got a certification in digital forensics. And then, like all good professors who are really just students, right, who just keep on learning, I went and I got a postdoctorate from the University of Maryland in digital forensics and cyber investigations. So it doesn't, you don't have to be at that level. You know, like Diane says, start where you are and just keep working your way up. I just want to let you know, another shameless plug, since I have the mic, that at Rider, what we're doing is we received a grant from the Center for Inclusive Computing at Northeastern University to develop a cyber bridge for all majors. Doesn't matter where you come from. Photography, we'd love to have you, Diane. And so we're, my colleague, Dr. Kara Tang is in the audience. We're developing that bridge. So if you're interested in pursuing maybe a graduate certificate or a degree, and you don't think you have the background, this bridge will, and it's online, self-paced, you don't have to come to New Jersey. If you want to try to get a graduate certificate, we'd love to talk to you, okay? And the pilot is starting in the fall, and there's no cost to you, and we'll pay you $300. Be part of the pilot. Okay, moving on. Okay, career, what is the difference between the Career Village, which is right next to us in Adams A Room, and the Career Fair, which is in the Aurora Exhibit Hall, which is near where you registered? Okay, I got, let's see, Elizabeth. And then Esther, Collins, and Litany.
Okay, so the Career Fair is where there are booths for all of the different companies that are recruiting and trying to get new talent. So that's what the Career Fair is. They've got booths there. Then tonight, the socials are some of those businesses that are willing to spend money on y'all for like hors d'oeuvres and some sodas and stuff, and sometimes they have some extra swag, where they're trying to talk you into considering a career at their company. So that's the Career Village. The Career Fair. The Career Village is where you can do mock interviews, you can have your resumes reviewed, you can have conversations with people about your career, where you are, what your path is gonna be, what you wanna do, how you get started. What else?
Headshots,
yes, headshots are usually close to the Career Village as well. So the Village is where you're developing, it's all of the development activities, and then the Fair is where you actually look for jobs, talk to people.
Yeah, and I think they also have a printer at the Career Village, so you can print out your resumes if you forgot. They might also have printers somewhere in the hotel, but this is very convenient. Okay, they have a FedEx. But from what I've noticed, the Career Village tends to be the least crowded, like towards the start of the conference, and then the headshot lines get really long, so definitely try to plan ahead. And it'll also, of course, help you in the Career Fair.
So for the Career Village, I would advise a lot of us to visit the Career Village. I have my reasons. This is where you meet with people that are subject matter experts in building your resume. This is where you meet the HR team that they're gonna tell you exactly what they look for when they put out job out there and help you tell all those things. This is a place where you can get insight as for what your resume is speaking. Is it speaking to the recruiters or just speaking only to you? They have a fair criticism of what you've put down and they help you to correct that. That's the Career Village. But in the Career Fair is where you have opportunity to talk with the companies you are targeting, right? Look at what they have and where you can come in. And the Career Fair actually, for me, makes sense when you come out from the Career Village already prepared with your one-page resume to hand over and say, have a look, does this meet what you're looking for? So both workshops or events that you don't want to miss.
Whitney.
And just to piggyback on what everyone said earlier, the career fair is really where you put everything that you did or potentially did at the Career Village into action. So with the mock interviews, now you can go to X booth and have a conversation about your interests and the jobs that they may have available and how you fit that job description. And so I think during the Career Village first and getting your resume looked at and during those mock interviews will really help you when you decide to go to the career fair.
Excellent, thank you. Going on to the next question, number 8, and I want to call an audible if it's okay, Dr. Elizabeth, if you could chime in on this one as well. If you can. Okay, what positive changes for women and other underrepresented groups in cybersecurity have you professionally experienced from the first WiCyS Conference in 2014 until this conference in 2023? We can have Diane and then Elizabeth go, since the mic doesn't matter. Go ahead, Elizabeth.
Okay, so I started at the 2019. That was my first WiCyS. And what I'm going to say is the sense of community and the resources that are available now are tremendous in a 5-year time span, what's happened. And awareness. Awareness is a simple little word, but it's huge. There are a lot of people that do things that are very exclusive behavior. They don't even realize they're doing it. And so awareness makes a huge difference. And in the last 5 years, we've done a tremendous job with awareness. My dad's a retired Navy captain, and he's totally old school. My sort of posting, like my International Women's Day posts and my short little explanations of why that day is important, and then every year coming to WiCyS and my little posts about what this means to me, that has changed his mind and made him more aware of, oh yeah, there really is something going on there. So awareness has become a big deal, and it's starting to level the playing field.
And why don't you just pass it to Esther? And then Diane, you can back clean
sure.
up.
Yeah, the conference, like the size of the conference has really grown since the first one in 2014. I think the stats will be presented at one of the keynote sessions. But also just the amount of resources that companies have dedicated and organizations to really help fund and support the conference. As well as like the scholarships that have been awarded, and like they now have a student emergency fund. All these different things are just, they've been so amazing. And also like aside from awareness, just the level of inclusivity that they have, just trying to welcome everyone from all backgrounds. It's just really incredible. And so, I don't know, when I'm here, I just feel really welcomed and supported and just not judged. I feel like I can be myself, and I think that's the best part.
And I'll chime in kind of from the perspective of what I see out in the industry. So I definitely agree. There is an awareness that diversity is really important. And so companies are understanding that it spurs more innovation, it creates trust within their employee base. People are more productive when they can bring their whole selves to work. And it also helps us better understand our customers and how to connect with them. So, you know, there's a lot of funding for diversity, equity, and inclusion programs now. I mean, the fact that, you know, I'm sitting here as a sponsor, it's important to our organization. You know, we're seeing training of the employee base on these concepts. We're within the recruiting process, they're making changes like on the resumes, they're hiding the names so that there isn't some unconscious bias made. We're making sure that there's diverse panel, you know, diverse people that are on the interview panel. So making all those changes, they're even tracking, you know, how many women are in leadership roles, how many underrepresented groups are in leadership roles, and is there equity in pay? So those are all fantastic changes that I've seen. There is still work to do, though. There's definitely still work. You know, security at large across the industry is 75-80% male, and there is unconscious bias. It's not, you know, honestly, I don't see blatant bias anymore, but there is still unconscious bias. And so I guess the thing that I just say to you is if you encounter those type of situations, you know, definitely stand up for yourself or somebody else if you see it happening to somebody else, but please maneuver those situations with grace. Be tactful, be graceful, and, you know, and it'll just really help to ensure that there's a positive outcome.
Beautiful. I'm actually going to weigh in on this a little bit since I'm a statistics nerd. So what I want to say is that a high tide raises all boats. WiCyS is dedicated to ensuring a rising tide for all women. In 10 short years since WiCyS began in 2014, the percentage of women in the cybersecurity workforce increased from 10% to 25%. That doesn't seem like a lot, but we're moving the needle, just like Diane said, 75 to 80%, right? So I just wanted to put that out there that this organization and other efforts are really making a difference, and you can too, by getting employed and working hard. And thank you. Okay, question 9 of 10. These are a little easier. What should you do if you want to attend multiple presentations happening at the same time? And China, you had your name against this one.
So there's always really great presentations always happening, and like you guys, I see them and you're like, oh, it's happening at the exact same time. And it's like, okay, how do I be in two places at once? And obviously you can't. But my suggestion is, and what I've been able to do before, is if you definitely came with somebody, go to the session you want to go to, have them go to a different session, take notes, and then swap notes. And if you came here alone, this is a great networking opportunity for you. Go find somebody who was in the session and go and see if anybody took notes or if they can sit down with you for a little bit and actually explain what was happening. And then also you can go through the app and see if who the speaker was and see if you could pull them aside. And sometimes they might even send you their presentation so that you can go through afterwards and see what it was about.
Great. Litany.
So what I usually do, and Shina touched on it, is I contact the speaker ahead of time and say, I really want to attend, but I won't be able to. Is there a way that I can get your PowerPoint or your notes? And usually 90% of the time, 95% of the time, they're like, yes, sure. And if not, then I try to maybe go into like the program and see what the talk was about, and then see if maybe anyone who attended took notes, and if I can get it that way.
Great. And Elizabeth.
So tag teaming with notes, finding somebody that was there, right? And then talking to them. Also set up your own little network and split up who's gonna go to which session. And then at lunch, everybody start talking about what the session was and how I went and what were the information, you know, the key information points that everybody needed to get out of it. And then what resources did they share? Because a lot of the talks and workshops will give you resources. So that's a big piece to make sure that you pass on when you're having your little chats about what the different sessions were.
Okay, so this kind of dovetails. Toward the end of a presentation, most speakers leave time for Q&A, which we're trying to really hard to do that here. What should I do if time runs out and I did not get my question answered? Elizabeth, do you want to just answer that? Absolutely. Dr. Shiraz, let's give it up for Dr. Shiraz.
I'm so sorry to interrupt, Elizabeth, and But I came here for one reason, and that's to give hands to someone that we want to recognize as the WiCyS organization for her contribution and dedication for WiCyS organization. So save your applause for this person, okay? And the reason we are doing it now instead of keynote, because she's going to leave. She won't be here Saturday lunch keynote, so that's why you're the lucky ones. So this honor of WiCyS Advocacy Award goes to this person who has been an advocate for WiCyS, in fact, before WiCyS was born. And that's Dr. Elizabeth Hawthorne. So let's give a big hand to her. And you know, Elizabeth has been a cybersecurity educator like me for, I think, for more than me, 20 years now.
It's decades.
Yeah, decades. So don't count. So 20 years now. And she has contributed so much in this field, but I'm not talking about her contribution, intellectual contribution. I'm talking about how she stood by me when I wanted to start this organization and conference, how she stood by the organization, how everything she does, whether it's in classroom, whether it's at a conference, whether at some meeting, I'm not trying to embarrass you, but no, these are the facts. Everywhere she puts others in front of her own interest, she upholds WiCyS's mission, which is recruit, retain, and advance women in cybersecurity. So I am so honored that after 9 years, we are late to give you WiCyS, but this award is new. So WiCyS Advocacy Award to Dr. Elizabeth Hawthorne.
Thank you so much.
Yes, very good, thank you. And you know, she will be here for next, you're leaving Saturday morning?
Friday night.
So if you see her, please talk to her. And I'm just going to do one thing. I can't stop giving you one more advice as a first timer. Don't be your own enemy, okay? Don't let you stop you from talking to someone that you want to talk to. Stop you from walking up to a booth and talking to the recruiters. Stop you from learning something here and then using it back home when you go there. Stop you from going to the next level in your career. So don't be you stopping you. That's all I want to say. Thank you so much. And thank you for this wonderful panel, and they're just, you know, they inspire me so much. So thank you again for being here. Bye.
Thank you all. I love WiCyS more than you can know. So why don't we skip this question, because this wasn't planned, and open it up. I think we can stay a few minutes and take some questions from the audience. I'm very humbled at this moment. So if you want to raise your hand and you have a question, Marina has the mic and she's going to be the runner. Oh, over there? Okay.
Hello, and thank you for organizing this conference and being here with us. I have a question about the workshops, and I'm asking, as a first-timer with zero or like little experience in cybersecurity, how do you know which of the workshops is like best for you? Because I think I attended a conference last year, and I went to like a workshop, and I didn't know anything they were talking about. So like someone with little experience, how do you know, like, do I have to have a prerequisite to attend this workshop or anything?
Okay, I'm gonna pass this to Elizabeth, and if you could repeat the question about workshops and how do we know which workshop to go to? Is that essence of the question?
Okay, so there are descriptions about the workshop. Little description that says this workshop, we're gonna do X, Y, and Z. So read the description, and if you're still not sure or you're on the fence, shoot an email to whoever's running the workshop, and they will usually get back to you and say, this is what we're going to be doing, and so if you're interested in this topic, please come.
Okay, we had another hand over there, I think. Yeah, over there. Thank you, Marina.
Thank you so much for your incredible advice. My name is Lena, and I'm currently a second year student at Columbia University. And one of my questions is that during the career fair, you get to talk to, the recruiters get to talk to a lot of people, and I'm wondering if you have any advice to stand out and to like kind of like, introduce yourself to the recruiter.
Okay, career village, is that right? Is that the question?
Career fair.
Career fair, I'm sorry, career fair. Who would like to answer that, career fair? Oh, China. Thank you, China. So repeat the question if you can.
Okay, so her question was how to stand out during at the career fair with like what you do. So I think it was actually the first when we had it here in 2021. I saw a recruiter from one of the agencies, I can't remember off the top of my head, and I pulled him aside and I was starting to talk to him, and he gave me, I think, one of the best advice that I've ever heard in my life, which was the way to stand out from pretty much, you know, because we can all get certifications, we can all go get the same degree, is to really do something outside of your comfort zone that really would make you stand out. So for me personally, I actually did my capstone in engineering with AIs and drones. So definitely going outside and like, so if you're not really a big programmer, doing a program project, anything in networking, just that really shows you that you can almost be an all over person.
Great, any other questions? Can we have a raise a hand? Okay, Marina's on the move.
I noticed in the description for the workshops that they're eligible for CPEs. How do we go about reporting it or counting those workshops toward certifications?
Sure, I can. You got it, Elizabeth? Right. So, yeah. So what you'll do is to record your CPE credits. After the workshop, they'll have a QR code, and you just can take your phone and shoot the QR code. Okay. It'll be very easy. Okay.
And there's no need to report to, say, CompTIA or GIAC?
Check with the workshop organizer. It depends on the workshop.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
You're welcome. Any other ones? Marina has some exercise going on here.
Hi, I'm an academic advisor for Florida International University. You had mentioned a pilot program which my online students might be interested in. So I would like more information about that.
Sure, can we connect about the Rider University's cybersecurity online bridge? Yeah, sure,
sounds
we'll
good.
Connect.
Thanks.
Hey, I'm in on that too, come see me as well.
Pick Elizabeth.
Yes, find Elizabeth.
Yeah. There you go.
Hello. Any green flags to look for when like looking for internships, and any red flags to look out for internships?
Okay, Diane, do you want to take that one about internships? Some advice about internships, I believe, what to look out for?
Well, like I said, Asurion does have two summer security internships. Is your question more around what is an internship like, or how to go about finding one? The second one, how to go about finding one. Okay, so honestly, I would start with the sponsors and strategic partners for WiCyS. I would look at their career sites, go to their early intern, early career pages. They'll generally have a specific site on their careers website for just specifically for that. Definitely go to the career fair. You know, hone in on the companies. I think that there's so many people going to be represent, so many companies represented there. It's easier if you target some that, you know, you might be specifically interested in. Do a little research on their website. Go talk to their recruiters. Really, that would be my suggestion. Most major companies have an internship program. And the other thing would be through, if you're through your school, a lot of times they'll have resources that can like plug you into internships. So definitely talk to whoever's on site on campus. That would be another one.
Okay. Well, that's fine. We're just running a little bit short of time. Any other questions? Marina, where are you? Okay. We'll get you. Don't worry. I promise.
So I'm a recent master's student who is going to graduate in May. I was wondering if you had any advice of between choosing an internship or a full-time offer at this point.
Elizabeth, do you want to do that one? So the question is, she is considering either taking a full-time job or going to graduate school. Oh, you graduated from your master. Gotcha.
So I'm going to say look for a full-time job and use the internship as a backup. If you're not able to find a full-time job to get you in, an internship might be a way to get in the door, because frequently companies will use internships as sort of a trial run, and it gives the student an opportunity to learn if they really want to stay with that company. So it's really kind of a two-way tryout sort of thing. So I would look for the full-time, but internships are a good alternative if you still need a way to get in.
Okay, good.
Hi, everyone. Thank you all for being here today. So my question is, for the career fair, how can we see the companies that will be there?
Okay, Kyle, Esther?
The question was, for the career fair, how do we see the companies that are going to be there? Yeah, definitely the WiCyS app, they have like a list in the main page of like all the different companies. And I think they might also have like a map of where all of the, what all the booth numbers are for the companies.
Esther, there's also listed in the
printed. Oh, okay. Oh, it's also listed in the printed version.
Okay. Next question.
Hi, my name's Abigail. I'm with MSU Denver, and I'm graduating with a degree in cybersecurity this May. I'm wondering if I can use your answers from like question 6, asking whether a degree or a certification is the right path for you. My senior thesis is actually on that exact question on how to get into that program or into a job. So I was wondering if I could use your answers as part of my research.
Sure. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yep. This, like we say, this will be recorded as a podcast and you can just pluck it from there. We're
Thank
honored
you.
That you want to use our answers. Okay. Anybody else? We got a couple. Marina's running. She's running.
We got
some
up
front. We'll get to y'all.
My name is Mark Ojola Feishayo from Robert Gordon University. I want to know, you talked about us printing our resume. Like, how many copies do we need, and what exactly do we need it for? Thank you.
Okay. Litany, do you want to take that one?
The question was about the resumes and how many copies you need. So for me, I always say bring a minimum of 5 to 10, 10 max, so you can hand them out. And so you may, and depends on where you're going or which booth you're going to, or so pick out your top 10 maybe, or if you want to do more, you can. I'm pretty sure you can go back to the Career Village and print out more, but I usually say start out with 10.
Okay, start out with 10 printed resumes, and you can always go back. Okay, where's Marina? You got the microphone? This lady had her hand up.
Okay, so I thought it was a great question she asked, because that was something that I was thinking about too, because I brought a certain amount of resumes because I know that mine needs to be edited, but the ones that I have are on resume paper. So the people that are here, if I print it from the Career Village, are they gonna care that it's on white paper?
Ooh, Collins, you wanna take that one? The question is, she has some that are printed, her resume is printed on some fancy resume paper. But if we go to the Career Village and print some other ones, they might just be on white plain paper. Do you think your company would matter, your recruiters would matter, if it was not fancy.
Yeah, so it's better to have it on a plain paper, right? Yeah, it's better to have it on a plain paper.
Okay, thank you.
Can I respond? Absolutely, Diane.
So I can tell you it was just incredibly helpful when I was manning one of those career fair booths. The fact that you have your resume is enough. I didn't care what the paper looked like. It was an opportunity for me to take notes on it, to like put a star and say, oh, I really like this person. So just, I wouldn't worry about the paper personally.
Thank you guys.
You're welcome. Okay, Marina, where are you running to? Oh, we have in the front, yes.
Thank you. Hi, I had a question about being an affiliate. So I'm looking for advice on where to go moving forward and how to become more successful and my talks with recruiters. And I want to take information from this conference and bring it into where I work. What would be your advice?
Okay, Elizabeth, do you think you can handle that one? And then maybe Diane tag team that.
So are you asking, should your affiliate help with development and networking?
My question is more in regards to the process of getting, I'm looking for more advice of how to set something like this up in my experience. With my affiliate, I need some more help to kind of plan how to establish the information I learn here in my job going forward.
Okay, so you could go to your affiliate and have your affiliate do career workshops, networking workshops, have one that's specific to your affiliate. So if you're in one of the cultural affiliates like the military, it would be specific for that group. If it's regional, it would be specific for whatever the region is. So I'm in Florida, it would be stuff typically in the Southeast, we've got a lot of military and government and that sort of thing. So you can set it up through your affiliate and it'll be specific for the needs of that affiliate. If your affiliate's having trouble getting something like that set up, have your affiliate leaders talk to other affiliate leaders. We're happy to share. We talk all the time. And we love sharing what's been successful with one affiliate with another affiliate so that the success can travel on down the line.
Okay, I think we have time for two more questions because I think the other presenters want to get up here.
Hi, thank you all for coming. I really enjoyed the presentation. I'm a sophomore in college and my major is computer science, but my focus wants to be cybersecurity. So I was wondering, would my coding experience hold me back from being successful in cybersecurity since I'm like struggling with the coding right now? Or how do I get more involved with cybersecurity if we don't have many classes at the college I'm at?
Great. China, I saw you grabbing. China, yeah.
I love that question because so our university, we have four different paths, which is like programming, a bunch of other stuff. Programming is going to help you so much. I struggle with programming all the time. There's this great website called, if you check out GitHub or W3 Schools, it helps with it. Cheat codes, amazing. And anything and everything will help you. I definitely recommend reading anything cybersecurity, so any books that pertain to it. Even though I haven't taken the certification yet, Security Plus, because it's so broad, it'll help you just reading the book itself and going through and breaking down. I definitely recommend reaching out to professors that are in cybersecurity or anybody through LinkedIn or anything that you can find, especially here at the conference, and just talking to them and just picking their brain. And I'm sure people can give you books and stuff that you can read.
Great. One last question.
Do you mind if I chime in?
No, go ahead, Diane.
As well?
Since we don't have another question.
So I just want to say that application security is a huge domain within the security space, and you need to understand coding and development and all that in order to be successful there. So a lot of times we pull from the development organization in order to fill those type of roles and then train people up. But if you've got that blend of, you know, of both the cyber side plus the coding side, you're, yeah, that's brilliant. So definitely keep pursuing that.
Anybody else? Going?
Could I add something too about the previous question if there's no other thing? Oh, yes, because my background's also computer science, and I didn't really do much cybersecurity in undergrad. Like, I was just part of a cybersecurity club that we had. So I don't know if there's like a WiCyS club at your university or cybersecurity club, but those are definitely great ways to get involved. But I decided to do a master's degree, and I specialized in cybersecurity, so depending on what your, you know, career path is, like if you're able to get a master's, like they usually have like very specialized courses, and that will allow you to kind of dive deeper into that on, you know, a more academic level. And then, yeah, after I graduated with my master's, that's when I started, you know, looking into certifications. And like, I'm technically a software engineer, but I work in the security org. But it's always useful to have, like, you know, that security knowledge.
Okay, one last question. That's okay. They're not breathing down my neck just yet. That's okay.
That made me think of something. Is it possible for someone to pursue a master's in cybersecurity without a computer science undergraduate degree?
Elizabeth, you're biting at the, chomping at the bit there.
Yes.
Like, all kinds of yes.
Make your plug.
Whatever your background is, there's usually a master's degree that has a cybersecurity spin on it that's based in that discipline. So, for example, you can get a master's degree in accounting that specializes in forensic accounting, which is a huge area in cybersecurity. The expectation there is that everybody's coming into that with an accounting degree or a business degree, and then they're picking up the cyber as they go through the master's. So, yes, in every industry, in every kind of field.
Okay, and I got to call it at that. Thank you all for coming. We really enjoyed our time together. And keep in touch with us throughout the conference. We're here.